So I'm going to tell you a sad story and show you some horrible images. But it's up to you whether it has a happy ending. And you'll figure that out by the time we get through this. So North Atlantic right whales, 45 feet long, 60 tons. When they calve in northeast Florida. They feed up here in Cape Cod Bay, Great South Channel, Bay of Fundy, Gulf of St. Lawrence. They used to be all over the North Atlantic, but we killed most of them off years and years ago. This whale on its tail on the left there, you can see those white marks. Those are rub marks, scars from entanglement in fishing gear. We can identify the individuals by the patterns on their heads and catalog them. So as those photographs are taken through the years of these all these different individuals, we get a very good idea about the whole species in terms of what's going on, because there are so few of them. We have a better record of this species than any other wild animal in the world, really. I'm going to tell you a story about Bela, catalog number 3911. She was observed entangled Christmas Day 2010 off of the coast of Georgia. Colleagues of mine took photographs from the plane. This is one of them. She was disentangled two or three times. The folks here in Provincetown really promulgated the whole disentanglement process for aiding entangled whales. This is ground zero right here in Provincetown for large whale disentanglement and training globally as to how people do that. And in spite of the disentanglement for this animal, it died 2 weeks after the last disentanglement event. So this sketch here is of Bela and the entanglement that it had. And you can see that both flippers around the head and the trailing gear. So entanglement causes constriction and partial amputation and loss of body weight. And the drag, these ropes here, they can make a huge difference to the ability and the cost of the animal to move through the water. And all of that adds up for the females as a loss of the ability to get pregnant, nurse, and suckle calves. And we talked about the disentanglement for Bela. This is another photograph of it. And it was really exciting to be involved in this. We gave the animals a sedative in this case to make it more approachable. And as you can see here, it's approached very easy to approach now with that boat. But ultimately, the disentanglement didn't help it. And the disentanglement of large numbers of animals is simply not possible because we don't encounter the majority of the animals that are entangled. So that leads to, you know, it's a palliative thing, and the folks doing that will be the first to tell you that that's the case. So how do we deal with this entanglement problem? And I'll tell you that, but I just want to give you a little bit more of an idea of the impact, and recently the increasing impact of the entanglement problem. So red here is the entanglements that have been recorded since 2002, and gray are the vessel strikes, the ship strikes. Both are problems, both remain problems, but as you can see, the entanglement problem has been progressively getting worse in the last, well, really since 2011. The ship strikes in 2017 were primarily up in the Gulf of St. Lawrence, but we also had one in Cape Cod Bay at the beginning of the year. Along with that increased entanglement, and it may just be a correlation, but I think there's some causation involved as well, the calving rate, the annual calf count through the years since 2002 again, has been shrinking over the last 8-10 years. And indeed, in 2018, the calving season ended in, say, May, not a one calf this year. So along with the mortalities that we saw in Canada, the 17 animals that died in 2017, Canada and New England waters, with this calving rate going down to zero at the moment, there's been more press about North Atlantic right whales and their plight in the last 6 months than there have been in the last 10 years. It's been extraordinary. We've all been very busy communicating about this. But ultimately, what I'm saying tonight is what's going to change the whole situation. So you're on the side of your seats. You're ready for this. So am I just whistling Dixie? There's no way we can do this. Or is there a real chance that we can turn this really dire situation around? So the yellow up there is the North Atlantic right whale's traditional habitat. Most of it's on the eastern seaboard now. The brown is the southern right whale, a sister species. And then the up in the Pacific, you've got the North Pacific right whale, which is another story unto itself. But if we look at the trajectory of the southern right whale, it's really, really encouraging, because whalers knocked them down heavily in the 1700s and 1800s, and then they started to come back in the 1950s, and then the Russians went after them again in 1960 to 1970. But after that, you can see that trend going up, and it's around 7% a year. That's pretty good growth for stock, so we'll stick with that. And I seriously believe that if we leave right whales alone in this habitat, the North Atlantic right whale, they will do so much better than they are right now. So this is about a 1 to 2% growth rate since 1990, which then again fell off in 2010 and continues to fall now. And it's a reflection of food moving, climate change, but also the impact of entanglement and also the vessel strikes that we've seen. So if this line doesn't change, we're not going to have any reproductively active female right whales in, say, 20, 25 years. So now is the time. We don't have time to fix climate change, but we do have time to fix the entanglement problem. What is the entanglement problem? Well, I told you about 3911 and Baylor. This is the last photograph I'll show you of Baylor. It's a photograph that I took of a section that I cut in the lip of Baylor after she died. She came onto the beach. We wanted to figure out, you know, all we could about the animal. And inside that red, that yellow circle is the cut end of, of a piece of the rope that was, she was entangled in. And it ran through her lip for about 4 or 5 feet, and it cut through the skin. You can see the furrow where it moved down through there. The white is the scar in the skin of the lip. And when I saw that, I knew I had something of great importance in terms of understanding and communicating what this problem is. And I told that animal that I was going to tell its story. And my prayer today is that that story is not being told in vain. So how do we turn this around? Trap gear, lobster, snow crab, other shellfish is laid on the bottom, either single traps and pots or in a chain. And if they are strung out together, the line between along the bottom today is sinking line, so it doesn't get up in the water column. But what remains is what we call the end line. The end line runs from the trap up to the surface buoy. There's numbers on the buoy to identify it, but also they use the line to haul the trap, to service it, to take off the harvest, and to put in new bait. So that's where we know the whales are getting most entangled today. And how do we change that? Well, on the right is the solution. We get away from end line, and we create a virtual end line in the form of an acoustic pinger on the trap and a receiver transducer on the vessel, which goes up to the cloud, so you can see on the plotter in the wheelhouse where the traps have been set, so other vessel users or the bottom users, draggers, can see where not to go. And we also have to have a remote retrieval, either an acoustically triggered buoyancy device to come back up to the surface, or a traditional grapple. You throw it over the side, you know where it is, you tow it along the bottom and you pull it up. None of these are going to be as simple as the end line of today, but it may be that it's a compromise that can work and be economically viable. So in thinking about all of that, put this in the context of the next lobster dinner that I hope you're going to eat, because I'm not saying don't eat lobster. What I am saying is we can change things around so that we can feel good about the lobster we're eating. Think about Baylor and these images the next time you eat crab or lobster. But none of this is going to happen unless we can do this in a collaborative and a supportive and an economically viable way for the industry and industries involved. So I like to think of lobstermen as my neighbor, whether they are or are they not, because they're somebody's neighbor. This isn't like ocean trash. In fact, for large whales, ocean trash is a relatively minor problem, unless you're a suction feeding whale, which these are not, to the actively fished gear that we have here that's being set on a daily basis and being run into on a daily basis. So we've got to figure it out working with these guys, working with the managers, working with the various regional lobster and crab associations as to how we can do this all together. And you as consumers are driving this, will drive this, as ethical consumers demanding that we have lobsters and crab that are caught without using an end line. So thank you.